There's one item that I was supposed to talk about yesterday. It was the notions of sight, which is important in the theory of topos. So I would like to start today with discussing a bit this notion of sight, and then I will talk about the logical aspect of topos theory. So I may use the first half hour for discussing the notions of sight. Well, a sight is is a small category. C equipped with the grossing the topology. So I will describe more precisely what this means. Olivia already said something about it yesterday, but I want to stress the fact that what we do is that we have the category of perceived on C, which is a topos, and we somehow want to take a quotient. I'm thinking of the group of topology as providing some kind of relation so that you can take a quotient. So you have a quotient map, Q, which is a geometric, well, not exactly a geometric, an algebraic morphism of topos. So Q preserve coordinates and finite units. It's an algebraic morphism of topos. You may want, I mean, from a geometric point of view, you may want to see this as a subtopos of that, so you reverse the picture. But I want to think of it as a quotient. The Grothendieck topology is really what you need to take a quotient of a topos from an algebraic point of view. So I would like to discuss these questions of quotient and topology. First, maybe with soup lattices. So suppose that L is a soup lattice. And suppose that you have a set of pairs, phi, L plus L, a set of pairs of elements, and you want to take a quotient of L in the category of soup lattices. So a quotient, L is a quotient. So has to identify, you want to take the equalizer of all these pairs. So you want to have that QA equal QB for all AB in a universal way. Well, what you do normally, I mean, in algebra, is that you construct the congruence of a relation generated by phi, and you take the quotient. Maybe, yeah, so this is a notation for the congruence relation generated by phi. But in the category of soup lattices, something very nice happened, is that you can construct this quotient right away. So let me write L phi, oh, let me say that definition, an element x in L is, let's say, phi sheaf, if for all a b in phi, a is smaller than politics, and if b is smaller. In other words, if you call an element a phi sheaf, if the element is not able to see the difference between A and B, to see the difference on this side. Okay, so in other words, X is a phi sheaf. If when this is true, this must be true also, and conversely. Okay. Now, if you write L phi for the set of X and L, X is a phi sheaf. This subset of L is actually closed under a FIMA. This is really very simple. Okay, let me very quickly sketch the proof. Suppose that you have a family of elements in L phi. I want to prove that the infimum, let me write X, the infimum is again in L phi. Well, you start, suppose that, for example, that A is smaller than X, then, of course, for all I, and since this is a phi sheaf, for all I, and since this is true for all I, and the reverse implication is true. So this is closed under infima, and since this is closed under infima, it implies that the inclusion has a left adjoint. Which, if I call the inclusion U, then the inclusion has a left adjoint U lower 3 from L to L phi. This is true from, I can write a formula for U lower 3 of something. U lower 3 of an element X will be the infimum of over all Y such that X is greater than Y and Y is in L. That's a formula for it. And this U lower 3 being a left adjoint is a morphism of soup lattices, and it's the solution to the universal problem of identifying A and B. So if you have a map F with the conditions that F of A equals F of B for all AB, then you will be able to, I leave it as an exercise to extend. Okay, but what about if the lattice is a frame? Suppose that L is a frame. Yes, thank you. Suppose that L is a frame, therefore, I mean, it means that the amphenon is distributed, right, over the frame. It's a lattice, but with the extra property that you have this distributed build-up. Okay? And when is it true that the quotient there is a frame? You would like to have the quotient to be a frame now, okay? What I just described is a kind of purely linear theory, in the sense that the sublattices are like abelian groups, suprema is like addition, and I just told you how to make a quotient of an abelian group by some something, right? But now suppose that L is a ring, and you would like to know when is the quotient a ring and when is it the solutions of the problem in the ring aspect. So, but you need that phi is, so let's say G and L, the set of generator, now, what kind of generator? I mean, sublattice generator or frame generator? You see, there's a slight difference between the two. I think frame generator. So, I'm just now maybe I should be careful. I will take sublattice generator. So, this is a bit. Yes. So, sublattice generator. And I'm going to say that phi is, let's say, stable or something. So the condition now, add the condition. That G phi is contained in phi. So what does it mean? It means that G in G and AB in phi implies that G A G, B, which is stability under putback, or if you like, in a section, in phi. Okay. Then, the same construction give you a frame quotient. And L phi is a frame quotient and it solved the problem of picking a quotient of the frame with respect to the given system of relation. So this is a little bit like saying, that's an idea. And I put the condition here only for a set of generator because very often that's the way you want to check if something. You don't need to to check for every element of phi. You just need to check for a set of generator. Again, this is not difficult to prove, and it's like you will probably enjoy proving it yourself. Okay. So I will not take this pleasure from you. Okay, now this pattern is just repeating itself in sheaf theory. This is exactly the same thing. However, I would like here to make a point about the fact that the pre-sheaf on which is D of P. So if you have a poset P and you have the unida embedding Y, D of P is the poset of downward sections of P, and we know that this is the completions of P under suprema as a soup lattice. This is the solutions of a linear problem. But it happens that D of P is also a frame. Okay? It's a frame. It's given to us, I mean, as a frame. But as a frame, it's not free. This is a frame, but it's not the frame freely generated by P. The frame freely generated by P has another construction, which we first add finite meat to P. Okay? And then we complete it by adding suprema. That's the frame really generated by P. That's this thing. This arrow. Okay. So this one is not free. The generators, of course, are the YX. Okay. D of P is generated by the YX with X and P. But there are the relations. So I would like to discuss the relation between the generator of DFP as a frame. The relations between the generators of D of P as a frame okay. The first relation is that the supremum of all the generator is the top element. The generators, you see, this was true also. What I'm going to write will be true in D of P as a soup lattice. But I cannot write this relation in the theory of soup lattice because this element here belongs to the notions of frame. In a soup lattice, there is a top element, but it has no name. I mean, well, I can say it's the top element, but it's not preserved by morphism of soup lattices. Okay? So, if I write these relations, I want to write the relation between using formulas in the theory of frame. And I cannot write this relation in the theory of soup lattices because this element won't is not a constant or an operation in the theory of soup lattice. It's not preserved. So that's the first relation. And the second relation is that these relations are very easy to check, right? The first just means that P, the top element, is the union. You see, if I use, since I am in DP, I can use union, and this is clear, right? Every element is, the similarity from this one, okay? You see? YA meet YB is not a generator in general. I mean, if P was a meet lattice, then YA meet YB would be equal to Y of A meet B. Because the unit are embedding, preserve, intersection when they exist. But when they don't exist, the intersection between the two is not representable. But, however, it would be a suprema of things that are representable. So, and you just write it down, okay? So these are the two relations. It's an easy exercise to check that this is a presentation of DP in the theory of soup lattices, in the sense that if you have a frame A and if you have a map phi that satisfies these two relations, where A is a frame. There would be the linear extensions, which is just obtained by using suprema for S downward sections.
In the diagrams, not D, but P.
Ah, thank you.
So under it was P.
Yes, right. So you have a map, you extend it linearly, and then you prove that phi prime preserve intersection. Just from 1 and 2. 1 and 2 is exactly what you need in order to prove that. Okay. So, in particular, a point of a frame, we call it a point of a frame, is a morphism, is a character. So what are the points of D of P? Of the frame, D of P, of the frame, are subsets F in P that satisfies such that two conditions, P is not empty, F is not empty, and 2, A, B in F implies, well, I should say also that F is upward close. Yeah, that should be. Okay. Mm. Okay, I forgot. F is upward. So this notion here is what you could call a prime filter on P. Okay, it's a prime filter on P. And why is this true? It just follows from these conditions. A character will be on D of P. If you restrict the character to P, you will have a map from P to 1. It will be the characteristic functions of something satisfying this condition here. And if you look at this condition, you see that it will be the characteristic functions of a prime filter. So F is a set of X in P shows that P of X is 1. Okay.
Sorry. What did you do here at the end?
Okay. I'm looking now. First, I'm describing the characters of this frame. Okay. The character will be a frame homomorphism. Now, the frame homomorphism, if I restrict it to P, okay, so I take the restriction to P, you have the generator, the restriction to P will have to satisfy the relations that I have written here, because it's the case where A is the is bracket 1, and this phi is actually a phi prime, and actually I'm looking at the restriction here, and it must satisfy this condition. And if you translate this condition, you get this one. Okay. okay. So, in general, when you construct a frame, you may construct it from generators in general. So you have a frame A and you would like to have a presentation describing the frame as a quotient Q from some, these are very easy to construct, the D of P. This, so you should know that, of course, this frame is not free. Okay. But you need also a Grothendieck topology, possibly, in addition. So that's the, I mean, you need to take a quotient, so, and then to have an isomorphism here. Okay. So that's more or less the general constructions of a frame. You pick some generator, linear generator, because you want to have this as a subjection. So some elements having the property that every element is a supremum, a linear generator. But these linear generators should satisfy some relations, which are the, okay. And then you pick a topology, and okay, that's the way you construct the. And the topology very often is a bit less, not as general. I said D of P. And instead of having a relation here, you may as well have a relation here. Okay? So it's a relation between the lower sections and the elements of P. And this relation, phi of S, let's say A, is S cover A. So S, normally S would be contain a sub a subset of our tree, and you want to say that S cover A, and that's the or phi cover. You see that you introduce a covering relation like this. You want to say that certain lower sections are coverings, the generators. And then you need to say that some stability condition, that if S covers A, implies that S intersection B, B, cover B for all B smaller than 8. Okay? That's the stability condition. And then the notions of sheaf is defined using that. And that the notions of sheaf mean something like this, that T in D of P is a sheaf. If for all S covers, S in T implies A in T. Okay, that's the sheaf condition. Okay, so that's the picture for the theory of frames, and it happens that this picture just repeats itself completely for the for topos. It's the same, except that you have to be a bit careful. There are morphisms around, etc. Yes.
When one starts with a quotient topology and one defines a sheafification,
yes,
one is obliged to do it in two steps to repeat twice the sheafification.
Okay.
What is the analog here?
That's a good. I was hoping that nobody would ask me this question. You see, I'm a little bit cheating here because I'm making things simple, which is correct. I mean, this is correct. Well, from a conceptual viewpoint, you would like to know how you construct this sheafification, okay? Which I said nothing here. Because what I did was to say, what is a sheaf? And then I proved formally that there is a best approximation, given something which is a pre-sheaf, there is a best approximation as a sheaf, which is I call the sheafification. Okay? So I don't need to worry. The definition is there. But of course, you may want to construct a and then you do as usual. You do as usual. In other words, in order to be able to construct a sheaf, you need to put some extra conditions on the topology. I said nothing about compositions of coverings here, which was important in the definitions of what a Grothendieck topology is. This is some kind of pre-topology. Okay. So if I want to construct the sheaf, I will need to have an extra condition of the covers to be closed under compositions, and then I just repeat what we do usually.
But what I was asking is, I suppose the same difficulty arises already for locals, that you have to repeat twice.
No, because in the case of sheaf, no, I don't think so, because in the case of sheaf, the first time you construct a separated sheaf, right? Yes. But if the sheaf is separated, you get it the first...
The pre-sheaf.
If the pre-sheaf is separated...
The first separated pre-sheaf, then you complete it.
And then, but if it happens that the pre-sheaf is separated, yeah. Yeah. Then there's nothing to do. But here, everything is separated because all the diagonals are triggered.
So in general, to construct the analog of the composition group of covering families in Grothendieck topology.
Yes.
So in this framework, so you have to make process what is the composition, but I suppose you have to iterate it.
Yes, exactly, exactly. Yes. Yeah. Exactly. If you have a cover like this, you may think of this as, you know, as a family of lower bounds of A that covers, right? A, and then if you want to call the compositions, you just... So the same thing is happening in topos theory. So first, you have the solutions of a linear problem. This is really free over a small category C. You take the pre-sheaf, and this is the free co-completion. Now, you may want to take a quotient of that. And how do you do a quotient? You pick a family of arrows. In fact, you could in PSC. You pick a family of maps between pre-sheaves, okay, or a set of arrows in pre-sheaf, and then you say that something is phi sheaf. If X does not see the difference, if the map from A on B, X on A, X on U, X is invertible, is an isomorphism for all u from A to B in phi. Okay. So that's the condition that X does not see the difference, not between A and B, but the object X thinks that U is invertible. And then it happens that if you look at the full subcategory of PSCR, the full subcategory of the pre-sheaf category, whose objects are the phi sheaf, then this thing has a left adjoint. This is a complete subcategory and it has a left adjoint, maybe L phi. It's sometimes called localization. And it's the solution of the universal problem. So you compose with the unit functor with L phi, The unit are composed with L I. If you have a functor here that inverts all the maps in phi, in the sense that well, you have to say that f power 3 of u invertible. By f power 3, I mean the continuous extensions of the functors of the pre-sheaf category. If this is invertible for every u or all u in R, then there would be functors here that is co-continuous and invert, and it's a solution of the problem of inverting all the arrows in pi. And this category is what we call presentable, or in the language of Gabriel and Ömer, it's called locally presentable. But today people have started to call that presentable category. So locally presentable or presentable category are the same. This is all presentable categories, so-called presentable categories, are constructed this way. You take a small category C, you take a small set of arrow, and you do this process, and you get... So it's a kind of generalized topos theory, in the sense that you just get here a category with co-limits, with generators, and that's essentially it. There is no other property than that. The generators are small, so-called, and etc.
Excuse me, I didn't understand just...
I'm sorry?
But can you start from, in this localization, you can start with what you call, instead of press sheaf of C, you just need it. This is what you call a presentable category, and then you take a set of arrows and you can do this, or do you need to start with a press sheaf?
With he?
No, to do this process of...
I did it for press sheaves, but you could start with a presentable category. Start with a set of maps here that you want to invert,
yes,
and localize, and you have the same theorem. Yeah. You don't need to localize from a set of maps in the category of pre-sheaves. You could localize a set of maps in a presentable category. But the presentable category are somehow defined by localizations of pre-sheaf categories.
You have axioms and phi, or...? Some compatibility. So
no. It's completely arbitrary. Yeah, that's the good side of it. There's always you start with. That's it. That's a theorem of Gabriel and Ömer. So that's the linear aspect behind topos theory. These are like abelian groups. Okay. But then you want to know when is this a topos, okay? And that's where the so-called Grothendieck topology happened. So our the notions of sight. So this Grothendieck topology here is the following data. Phi is a set of monomorphism S to the representable Y, A. So I'm choosing monomorphism this time because I want that the localizations be a topos, and this is called covering seed. Okay, A is a representable. A is in C. And So this S is actually a sub-precie of YA. So you start with the collections of monomorphism like this, and you suppose that the collection is stable under pullback, so condition stability. Under pullback. So that means that if you have something in if you have a map F from A to B in your category and you pull back the cover, the pullback needs to be in phi. This monomorphism needs to be in phi again. And now once this condition is satisfied, if you invert universally this class, you get the topos, okay. And this is called a site. You don't need that the monomorphism are stable under composition. You need that only if you want to construct using this sheafification, okay. In other words, what happens is that if something is a sheaf with respect to a certain class of monomorphism like this, it would be also a sheaf with respect to the classes that you can obtain by composition. To be a sheaf does not use the fact that the class of monomorphism that you choose is closed under composition. It's only about the constructions of the sheaf where it is useful.
It's like in ring theory. You can divide a ring by an arbitrary set, meaning dividing it by the ID generated by the set.
Yes, right.
And it has similar universal property.
Yes.
It's a universal ring which kills all the elements you are given.
Exactly.
That's exactly.
Right. Yeah, yes. It's really, really the same picture. Yeah. Okay. So, did I say enough about... let's see. How much time?
25 minutes.
I still have 25 minutes?
Yeah.
Okay. For the rest, I'm going to talk about the logic and topos theory. Olivia said something about it, geometric logic, in her course yesterday. So we'll see more today. But I will begin with higher order logic, which is a different subject in some sense. So this is theorem here. A topos, let me say, okay, a topos, okay, a topos, I'm defining, I'm giving a new, not a new, but yesterday I gave a characterization of what a Grothendieck topos is in terms of the Giraud axiom. Right, I described it to you. Now, I give another system of axiom, is a presentable category. Such that, which is locally Cartesian closed. With a subobject classifier. me.
You didn't define the concepts in the.
Locally presentable. Where? I'm sorry. Locally Cartesian. E is Cartesian closed. If the product counters, if it is Cartesian, so if it has product.
Finite
product. And the functor has a right adjoint. And the right adjoint is denoted as an exponential. So the right adjoint is denoted exponentiation by A.
And the right adjoint is an internal ohm?
Yes. Right. It's, so you have that A cross B to C, there's a the same as B. You see to the S, right? There is a bisection between these two kinds of mathematical bisection. And locally Cartesian closed mean locally. It means that in addition, all the slice topos, if you look at all slice category, they are Cartesian closed too. And so it means, for example, that there are pullbacks. Because if this has product, you need to have pullbacks in E, or fiber product, okay? Now, the sub-object classifier means that there is a universal universal monomorphism. So this universal monomorphism, the target of it is a certain, and the source turns out to be the terminal object. This needs to be proved, but this is, and the point is that for every A and every monomorphism, there exists a unique pullback square, like a unique map, such that this is a pullback. Okay. A nice way to express the universality of the monomorphism U is to introduce a category. The category of monomorphisms and pullbacks. So you look at the category where the objects are monomorphism and the objects are the monomorphisms in E, okay? And where the morphisms are the pullback square, okay? You look at this category, the category of pullback square. Pullback squares of monomorphisms, right? And this thing is saying that this category has a terminal object. This is the terminal object of the category of pullback square of monomorphism. That's one way of describing the universal property of omega. Okay. And
André, excuse me, il me semble que je devrais dire. Donc, si je comprends bien cette définition, c'est pas les topos de Rotelnik, c'est les topos élémentaires, c'est ça?
No, this is the group of the topos.
Okay.
And now, Lovir understood that you could do a lot just by the axioms that it is locally representable and a subgraduate classifier. I mean, most of the constructions are many could be done. So you drop the presentable. You just start with the category, which is locally representable with a subgraduate classifier, and that's the notions of elementary. Okay. And this is really very, of course, very nice, important discovery, because let's see, Mitchell. Saw also afterward that you could interpret higher order set theory. And two synastic set theory in any elementary topos. In other words, you can use the usual notation of set theory to work in a topos. You can, for example, the power set. The power set, what the power object is, which is defined to be definition to be omega to the A. Okay. you could say that omega to the A is the set of subset of A, for example. Okay. That's the power set. We know that P to the A is an object in a topos, and we know that it's not the set of subset. However, using this Birabu-Mitchell language, it shows that you can interpret this thing as meaning that, and as well as all the axioms of higher order set theory, and it's a model of set theory.
Which kind of set theory you speak about? Because in usual set theory, you can form higher and higher cardinals, so it, like bet alpha, for, and so does this exist in? I don't know.
Yeah. So there are some small restrictions of this kind of set theory. For example, you may have a natural number, and then you have P of n, and then P of n, it's all there, etc., it's all there. But you don't have, you may not have something beyond. Okay?
Okay.
So, but for most, mathematics is mostly involved with this sort of, okay? You don't need to go much beyond that, so it contains a big chunk of mathematics today, right? Yes.
Can low-if topos, which is not the Grothendieck topos, seen as the Grothendieck topos in some weaker model or set theory?
Okay. I don't know. I would like to know. Yeah. Okay. So, now, when I, Benabou first explained that, I think in a meeting in Montreal 1974, and I was very excited. I had worked with geometric logic before, but this was not geometric logic, it was the whole higher order logic. Because it was showing that you could do topos theory without using category theory. Okay. That you could somehow The point is not that you should not use category theory, but you don't need to use categorical notations all the time. Okay? You just make reasoning that are just like classical. And this is very good, because sometimes in category theory you have a proof and you have a huge diagram, arrows are moving all around, and you say, wow, what is this? It's difficult to understand. You have, or at least I find it sometimes difficult to understand. But if you succeed to translate what this diagram is saying in this language, sometimes it becomes obvious. So in other words, there is an alternative to understanding. It's not that you should not use category theory, but sometimes the classical notation are more comprehensible. And therefore, you should use it when it is the case. Okay. Okay. So, what is the main theorem of elementary topos theory from my point of view? It's the fact that if you take E in elementary topos, of course the topos doesn't need to be elementary, it could be a topos, okay? But what I'm going to say is somehow true the construction. Well, with the elementary topos, then you can do topos theory. You think of E as set theory, and now you start again, you do SGFR in E. So, for example, you first look at categories inside E, cap E. Okay. So what is the category inside E? It is an object of arrows, an object of objects, and a source and target map, and then a composition law that will be like a map like this, to C1. It's just everything. I mean, it's everything that you can do. Usually in mathematics, you can do it in a topos, and therefore you can do cap E. Okay? And then there is notions of a site. You can explain what is a site. And you can do topos theory inside a topos. Okay.
Yeah, but in SGFR, what they do...
I'm sorry?
I'm saying that in SGFR, what they do is a bit more complicated, because they allow to form things like the category of sheaves or pre-sheaves viewed as a site, but it will be a large site, so they use a larger universe. So they use more than what you allow, because in some proofs they need to say we reduce to the case of pre-sheaves, which is a use, which is a V site.
Universes and so for example, in topos theory you need the category of set, because you want to have pre-sheaves. Yeah. But the category of set is actually a big category. And therefore, Grothendieck used universes to make it smaller. And you have always this problem that you have smaller categories and big categories. And usually a pre-sheaf is something in a big category. Okay. The same thing happened here, in the sense that you define what a pre-sheaf is. It would be a family of an object over C0, okay, because you think of XA is the union of all the values of the pre-sheaf, A and C0, you take, okay. A pre-sheaf is like first a family of set, yeah. And then this family of set has an action, right? So, yeah. So you take T upper star of X, and then you will have a map, which is the action to S upper star. So it's if you see, like a descent condition, and etc. You can explain what is a pre-sheaf, okay? But this pre-sheaf, you will have a category of pre-sheaf, but this category of pre-sheaf will not be small. Okay. It will not be a category object in E.
So you cannot do the game of looking at, like in the J4, where they look at a grothendieck topology is like from the category of pre-sheaves, or like they can say that the topos is also obtained from the category of pre-sheaves, the canonical topology, by some topology, and then it's the sheaves and this. So you cannot do this.
I'm sorry, maybe we can discuss it after. Yeah. So, anyway, you have pre-sheaf on a small category C. C is a small category, okay? And this is an elementary topos again, okay? And you can add the topology, and you will get a topos. And this topos will have a geometric morphism to E. Okay. It will be equipped with a geometric morphism to E. And the theorem, I would say kind of fundamental theorem, or at least one fundamental theorem of elementary topos theory, is that you get all the category of toposes over E, the toposes over E, the topos that are equipped with a geometric morphism, the target, okay? So there is a category of toposes over E that equivalent, that all constructed from internal things here. So I would say that's the same thing as toposes, it's in E. It's a bit vague here because I have not really explained what a topos in E is, but it's essentially given by a site. A site is certainly a small object in E, and you can describe everything in terms of internal site, a small category in C, and with the topology. And okay, so this is kind of amazing. I mean, look. We have a topos, which you think of as a space. Okay, I'm drawing the topos. And then you have another topos, let's say F, and over it. Okay?
By means of a geometric morphism.
By means of a geometric morphism. Well, this whole thing over it is completely described by a small thing in E. See?
So should I read that equation as elementary toposes over E are equivalent to growth internal grothendieck toposes in E?
They are given by internal site in E. Okay. They are completely. Okay. So you can prove things about toposes over E by working in E.
So a geometric morphism of toposes in the case of elementary toposes, what is it? Is it is a pair of adjoint functions?
Pair of adjoint functions, yes.
Yeah. Exactly. F, let's say E is a grothendieck topos, so-called. I prefer to call it a topos than a grothendieck topos, right? And an elementary topos, I call it an elementary topos, right? I think that's the right terminology. And so E, let's say, is a topos, that is a grothendieck topos. F is another grothendieck topos. This is a geometric morphism. And you can, okay.
So could you explain again the result? Like, I don't get it.
This is a bit. A bit vague at the moment. I just want to essentially say, I'm just saying that if you have a grothendieck topos over E, then you can construct a site internally in E such that the category of sheaves on that side would be as a morphic web. You have a commutative triangle like this. Okay.
So a pre-sheaf is a contravariant factor from C to E?
Both.
Yes, and when you do the notion of a Grothendieck topology, you have to take a set of sieves, and do you take the set of sieves in the sense of set?
I'm sorry. Maybe we can discuss that after because I don't have much time. How much time?
2 minutes. Three.
Okay. Okay. So, in particular, you can do the theory of locales in E. I mean, some topos are very simple. They are with locales in E. So if your topos in E is a locale, you get a special kind of topos over E, which is called localic morphism. If your topos over E can be generated, can be described by a locale inside E, or if you like, a frame inside E, there's a theory of frame. The whole theory of frame that I described to you can be repeated in E. Everything I said is completely true again in E. And it gives rise to the notions of localic morphism in E. Okay? Now, there is a topos which is often denoted like this. It's a classifying object topos. It's the topos freely generated by one object. I mean, I denote it like this because it's like a polynomial ring. It's in the category of algebraic topos. In other words, if you have topos E and some object U in E, then there would be an algebraic morphism phi, algebraic, that takes phi of x to U. So, and this topos has a very simple description. It's the category of covariant functor from finite set to set. It is a pre-sheaf category. It's pre-sheaf on the category opposite to the category of finite sets. Okay. And it's kind of interesting to look at locales in this thing. Let's see, a locale. A frame. A frame in set X is a covariant functor T, or maybe from a finite set to frames, to the category of frames. See, a frame inside this topos can be described as a covariant functor from the category of finite set to frames. And this covariant functor has various properties. So, if you have a map from N to M, then you have a map from Tn, a map of frames from Tn to M. And this TF, and TF has a left adjoint, just F from Tn to Tn, and as well as other things, but the point is that T is a geometric theory. This is the kind of theory that Olivia was describing yesterday, but it's the purely algebraic view on it, in the sense that Tn is a set of formulas x phi, that's the notation, with the variable with the variable phi x contains in the first you have an infinite set of variables, so you look at, suppose that the variables are contained between the first x1 up to xn, and you look at these formulas and you take the logical equivalence relation given by you have axioms and you okay, and this this would be a frame by constructions of the logic of geometric logic, and it will satisfy all the axioms, and it will be a frame inside this topos. So what this thing seems to say, I will finish with
that. Syntactic category for some geometric theory that we're to describe. You see that this category set of X is a syntactic category for some for geometric.
This is not the classifying topos. This is classifying topos for a one sort.
Yeah, exactly.
If you have two sorts, you take two objects, polynomials and two variables. That's the only difference, right? Or etc. But the point is that I want to make is that the topology maybe can be understood as the study of frames. That's one interpretation of what general topology is. Okay, frame. Okay, so now we can develop general topology. Okay. There are all kinds of notions, compact spaces, and etc., all kinds of theorem, but we can do it inside the topos. We just repeat, but it's not always clear how to do that because the axiom of choice, we can't use it. It's a topology without the axiom of choice. And then, as a consequence of that, we get theorems about theories, okay? Geometric theories. So I think this is maybe a version of the duality idea that is expressed by Olivia in duality between theories, or maybe quotient theories. Okay.
This is a very specific.
Yeah. Maybe it's a version of this duality, or maybe it's an extension of this duality. I don't know exactly, but it is in the same picture. And I don't know how. I don't know. It's just an idea. Thank you. Yeah.